It's the Forensics Lunch. You know, I've been changing that from the Forensics Lunch to Forensic Lunch, and I don't know which one I like better. But either way, it's the lunch. Thank you for tuning in. As Leah said in the chat, it's his fault. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. We have another great show this week. And in fact, I don't know if I've... Matt, have I ever had shows booked out this far ahead before?
No. This is a first. Well, okay. It's about to be a first. We've had up to a month before.
I'm about to hit 2 months of fully booked out shows.
And we are indeed.
Yes. Yes. I've been hustling to make sure that we have people and plans and content in place so that way the lunch isn't a Wednesday me going, oh no, what am I going to do?
One of these days, I should probably do my part and help you out.
Matt.
I look for people occasionally, but...
Matt, you do your part every time you're here. As you can see, Matt's beard is growing in very well.
It's getting there.
I'm getting my quarantine beard pretty good here. For those who don't know, I don't trust myself to trim my own beard, so it's just going to grow until I feel comfortable going to a barber. hey, Alexis. Good to see ya. All right. Lots to talk about today. We got Oleg Skulkin on. He's going to be talking about the research he's been doing in feature usage. I got it right. and talking about what he's been doing to win the Sunday Fundays as of late. And who knows, maybe this Sunday he will get a continuous streak. We'll have to wait and see. Or actually this Saturday, that's when I reveal the winner. And so he's going to talk about what he's been doing, the research he's been working on. We got Brian Marks from our group here at KPMG talking all about Office 365 compromises and some of the fun things we're seeing there. Well, fun for us, not for the people it affects. We got Lee Whitfield. We're going to talk all about the forensic forecast nominations. Matt and I, every year, usually talk about who we would nominate to kind of encourage people to keep it going. Hey, Kev runs in Duncan. And of course, we always start with our friend Matt. Matt, what have you been working on?
Oh, just continuing on my long, never-ending project of Rust and Windows tools. So for the past couple months, I've been attempting to move over my ETL stuff from Python to Rust, and it's working pretty well, but I still have a long ways to go. There's a lot of things that Python made easy that Rust doesn't, but I just like Rust. So I'm trying to get all of my open source projects to move over to Rust or just not work on them anymore. Just kind of to get myself learning something new. I've been trying to learn it for a long time, and it seems like the more I mess with it, the better I learn it. So just seems like a good technique to me. But I thought I'd actually kind of show a little bit of where I'm at with it, what I'm trying to do, and actually share some screen.
You should. But before you do, Matt, wait, might I say what an incredible video background you have?
Well... I won't talk about who I'm going to nominate.
You can't see Lee's face right now, which is fantastic. On International Workers' Day, is there anything more appropriate than to talk about the plight of Clippy, who only wanted to help? So, Matt, go ahead. You get your screen shared?
All right.
Let me know when you're ready.
I feel...
Yes?
Did the wrong window. Let's do the right one. Alright. Maybe that'll work.
Yeah, it worked.
Alright. So, the ETL stuff, right? there's kind of two components to this.
There's something in the middle of your screen that is not being...
That's weird. That's my little tiny Skype... All right. So there's kind of two components to the event tracing. One is creating consumers and one is creating producers. And so on the system, you have all of these providers, and a provider could be like an application. It could be the system. Provider is what an application uses to define what messages it's going to create And that's kind of all that is. So then a provider or a I'm already kind of confused of where I was at. So yeah, anyway, so you create providers, providers and consumers, right? So and then so the provider kind of tells you who you're going to listen to. Mm-hmm. And it creates this kind of configuration of, I want to listen to all of these different channels. So you can listen to multiple channels at the same time. And then the consumer is what actually is reading from this provider. So in this example, so TraceView, it's one of the tools that comes with Microsoft's like driver kit. And it's a pretty, I like it. It's just a good kind of basic way to see what providers are publishing. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, so the consumer is the one that's reading these messages. And that's kind of what I'm working on right now, is just getting at a minimum this type of, I want to be able to read messages from the provider. Sorry, I'm working on the consumer. I want to be able to read messages from a given provider. It's like Inception, I guess. Maybe it's just that I haven't had enough coffee. Babies do that to you.
Babies do that to you.
I miss sleep.
You're going to miss it for a long time, buddy.
Yeah, I'm scared. Anyways, yeah, so this is kind of what I'm after right here. And the kind of where I'm not stuck at, but where I'm at currently is now producing, being able to parse out the message information, right? So I can get all the other stuff. And I'll show you that here in a second. And it's really cool because actually a cool trick that I didn't know about, let me pull up another window for you. Switch screens. It's so hard switching screens. So you should now be able to see my computer management. Mm-hmm. So under performance, this is where you actually see all of the registered providers. So you can actually go in here, event trace sessions. So you can monitor, or you can use a consumer to consume any of these already registered providers. In fact, if you were to launch Process Monitor right now, you would see a new kernel provider pop up. So every time Event Log Monitor, or anytime you use Process Monitor, it's actually the first thing it does is it starts up a kernel ETL provider. So that's kind of a cool thing too. But so like now, if I wanted to go and so test in TFS right here. So you see that if I go back over to...
I just got a big black screen.
Yep. Working on it. So if I go back over to the trace view, I created this provider with the session name test in TFS. And right now, this session is listening to the Microsoft Windows NTFS provider. So, and then you saw that just a second ago on my other screen. Mm-hmm. So now I'm going to switch over to my command line tool. I wonder if you can macro out switching screens. That would be cool. So right now I have this ETL consumer. And what I've been trying to do with it too is I want this to work not just with like in real time loggers, but I also want it to work with log files. So from here, I can actually load up any regular ETL file that's on disk. Mm-hmm. Or I can just listen in to a real time provider as well. So right now we have the test NTFS provider running. So let's just listen into that. So there it goes. So now you're basically getting the same thing that you saw within the Windows event trace, or what was it called? Trace view. So that's kind of like step one right now. But again, I'm not getting anything. I'm not getting the good stuff yet because there's just a lot of logic that goes into that part. And with a baby now, I'm just don't have the time to get there faster. So I get a couple hours in a week. I'm happy with where I've got so far. I got further than I thought I would, to be honest, because working with Rust and low-level Windows API has been a challenge. And every time I think I'm like, okay, I think I'm like 95% comfortable with working with the Windows API through Rust, then something comes up and I'm like, I don't know how to handle this situation. I've never seen how to pass this type of thing into the Windows API from Rust before. Now I got to figure that out. And it's actually kind of funny because, like, let's just listen to, or let's read a log file. So we'll go to Windows log file. Log files, WMI. I think I always like the Wi-Fi one. This mm-hmm. is the one that Nicole always does in her talks. And it's like, oh, there's an FBI van there. Why is there an FBI van outside of my house?
We all know why, Nicole.
We all know why. Anyways, so it's funny that that just actually kind of worked because usually it doesn't. But this is a great example of me. It always, there's a break. like, I cannot figure out why all this has to do is with passing a pointer. So when I launch the consumer and I call the Windows API calls, for some reason, whenever I do a log file, I don't know how to keep it alive, like, without freeing the memory again in Rust. So it just crashes, and you get like stack traces and error reports because I'm trying to access memory that's no longer there. Anyways, so just dealing with stupid stuff like that. However, I'm pretty excited about where I've got so far. So it's coming along. I'll run down the reasons why I want to do this one more time, which is it's not. Like, this makes for a great, triggering system. So one of my goals for a long time has been to monitor forensic artifacts in real time. But the challenge with that is it's not like there's any type of API that monitors forensic artifacts, right? Because generally they're binary blobs within some type of file format, and we want to see how our actions, you know, populate these artifacts. Well, a triggering system allows us to say, okay, every time this specific application touches this file, then we can run a parser on it, and then we can start doing differentials on the parsed out forensic artifacts. So that's kind of why I've been going after this. And what's nice, so right now I have the USN monitor, I have the MFT monitor, the Windows event monitor, all of that's in Rust on the same GitHub project. But what you really get with the event tracing stuff is actually being able to maintain process trees, basically. So if I want to look at a specific application and I want to see every time this specific application creates a file and then do something, I can do that. Whereas with, you know, monitoring the USN, sure, I can see that these files were created, but there's no way to associate it back to the specific process that created it. And then you can go down more further automation later on of, okay, I just want to, you know, I want to say, let's create a report of like all the things that this, you know, process just created or whatever, right? It gives you that flexibility later on. Anyways, yeah, that's where we're at.
All right. Thanks, Matt. So for those of you who were kind of a little lost there, if you've ever followed Nicole's presentation on ETL forensics, ETL is the application side of event logs, and she put out originally a Python parser and a C# kind of compiled program. This is Matt's Rust implementation of that, that hopefully you can extend the work and do some really cool stuff. ETL has a lot of possibilities the deeper you look into it. Let's move over to Oleg. Everyone, meet Oleg Skulkin. If you've never seen Oleg before, here he is. Hey, Oleg.
Hi, guys.
So, I wanted Oleg to come on for first one reason, and then it turned into two reasons. I'll explain what I mean. When Oleg won the Sunday Funday last week, and I was thinking, what could I do to kind of have a reoccurring set of scheduled guests? I was like, well, why am I not inviting the winner of the last week's Sunday Funday to come on the Forensic Lunch? Like, that is a missed opportunity. These are the people who not only deserve the work and the credit that they're getting, but people probably want to know what they're doing, how they're doing it, what's going on. So I wanted to bring on Oleg on for that. But then, in the meantime, while that was going on, Oleg also posted some new research. So Oleg, where do you want to start?
Oh, I think we can start from Forensic Lunch and then continue to this so-called research. I don't think it's real research, in fact, but we still can discuss it a bit.
Good enough to win.
Okay, so let's start from Forensic Lunch, from Sunday Funday.
Yeah.
So I think I won it a few times.
Yes.
I even counted it. In fact, yes. Yes. In fact, I won it three times, and the fun fact is that I won once in 2018, yep. Once in 2019, and finally one in 2020. So, and as far as I remember, all those wins were not so cool, because I think challenges were not the ones I wanted to win, because I submitted much more, and there was some really, really cool stuff. For example, the previous one about Microsoft Teams, it
yes.
was really cool.
Yes.
And I thought, oh, that's cool. I think I can do it. And I think I can win. Finally. Okay. Okay. I'm not.
You've been a runner up many times.
Yeah. So I think, okay, let's try it at least one more or two more times. And so back to maybe my first challenge, I decided to participate. Maybe there is another fact. I think some people know, but I don't think many people know. The first book I ever read about digital forensics back in, I think, 2011, mm-hmm. It was Hacking Exposed Computer Forensics, second edition.
Yeah.
And as far as I remember, you co-authored this book.
Mm-hmm.
And then I saw the change. I was like, oh, great. It's Dave Cohen. And he makes some challenges. I must participate.
Excellent.
And usually, many people have different habits. And I don't think, is it cool or not, my job is the same as my hobby. So I spend a lot of time reading, researching, trying to write some articles, some blog posts, etc. So any challenge like this is really cool. And I try to participate and find time to participate in any CTF challenges or challenges like Sunday Funday.
Mm-hmm.
So it's always cool. Of course, I don't always have time to participate because as my company is doing cybersecurity and we have a lot of incident response activities, so sometime you may work 24 hours a day and you just don't have any time to participate in any challenges. But thankfully, most of the time I still can find some time to participate. And in fact, I don't know if a lot of people submit stuff to the Sunday Funday.
It depends on the week, to be completely honest.
Oh, okay.
Some weeks I'm overloaded with responses, and I'm like, whoa, this is going to be really hard to pick one because they're really good. And other weeks, someone can just like sneak in a win.
Yeah, I see. I think I saw some posts that were like, okay, we have just one submission, and that's why the submission won. But nevertheless. So most likely it's not that difficult to participate, and I think many people should do it because it's great fun. It even if you think that you can't do it, I think you can. You should just try, because if you are familiar with many artifacts, if you are familiar with how digital forensics works, I think anybody can do some testing and get some results, so he or she can submit some to Sunday Funday. So
yeah. And
I don't know about some approaches. Mm-hmm. I just do it. So it depends on the challenge, in fact.
It's true.
Because they're true. Different. For example, I think the first one I won was about FAT32
yes,
timestamps.
That's right.
And it was extremely easy. I think anybody could do it. But it happened that I did it.
Yes. No, that was a good one. And you're one of the group of people who actually gets a good blog post out of your Sunday Funday result. A lot of times you'll post your research as a blog post on your site, so you kind of get double use out of it.
Yeah. Well, but again, it depends on the challenge, because
yes.
Last one I won on Zoom, I started researching it, and I found out that there is nothing. I thought,
there's a little
strange.
Bit. There was a little bit
and,
you found.
Yeah, a little bit, but anyway, I tried on another computer, created another account, asked my friends to help me with this. Mm-hmm. One more time, and one more time, and one more time, and I got the same results, and go, okay, if I get in the same results every time, so maybe it works, so that's why I decided to submit, because maybe not many people submitted, because they thought, maybe I'm doing something wrong, that's why I'm not getting anything useful.
Cyber Panther says, new to this, more info on Sunday Funday, please. Well, Cyber Panther, every Sunday on the blog that accompanies this podcast, that's hecfblog.com, there is a challenge posted each Sunday. You have a whole week to solve it, and there's a $100 Amazon gift certificate for the winner. So, Oleg, you also have a blog, so it's Cyber Friends Security,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And you post with another person?
Yes, so we started it back in 2016 with my colleague and friend Igor Mikhailov. It's another fun story because Igor always wanted to do something like forensic focus. Mm-hmm. And he was just, okay, let's do something. Let's do a blog, let's do a website,
yeah.
And I think we can do something like or even something better than it. Okay, why not? Let's do it.
Why not?
And so we started it, and I think first maybe 2 years, maybe 2.5, we posted quite a lot. So we tried to get some most important, most interesting news articles and post every day. Mm-hmm. And also we tried to post a new article every week. But then something happened. I think we got much more work. So unfortunately, it became much harder to do it on a daily basis.
It does.
And we are trying to continue working on it now. So we started it back in 2016. So it's 4 years already. And some posts, I think, got quite a lot of views. I thought some posts on Windows 10 forensics and on some cloud forensics got around 40,000 views, kind of that.
Yeah.
So quite a lot.
Yeah, that's awesome. All right, let's talk about the latest research you posted then on feature usage.
Ah, yeah, sure. I still don't think it's a research, but anyway.
Posted a blog.
Anyway.
It's research.
Yeah. So, in fact, we tried, I tried to find new sources of execution, because recently I had quite difficult incident response, and attackers, they deleted almost everything. And not many typical sources of artifacts very useful. So I think Shimcache was quite useful. I was able to find a lot of evidence for execution there. And I found some evidence of execution in SQM files. I posted about it at Cyber Forensicator as well, because it was the first time I found anything. And even I think it was the first time I saw that those files present on disk. And so I decided to check, maybe we have some new sources of evidence of execution, Windows 10. I think I just started from running Timeline Explorer and just trying to find using Registry Explorer, something in registry, because it's quite common source of evidence of execution. And very soon I found these keys, and I thought, oh, that's something new. I tried to Google it to find maybe somebody already posted about it, because it's quite a common thing. I can find something and then say, okay, it seems, and I Google it and it seems somebody already posted about it a year ago. Okay. And this time it went like this. I haven't found anything. So I decided that I should research more and try to understand and test a bit. So how it can help. Of course, it's not extremely useful because, for example, not many people, especially if we are talking about some incident response. I don't think that a lot of attackers pin some malware to the taskbar. But anyway, if, for example, they're using something like NetScan, for example, I think you should hear about it, like Cobalt Gang and other financial motivated guys used this tool. And if they use a few tools, and if they change from one tool to another using taskbar, they still can find some evidence of execution. So if you walked through the post, you could see that, for example, Mimikatz was written to the key as well.
Mm-hmm. That's cool. No, and you know, I think you're kind of saying, you know, I don't think this is that interesting, or you know, maybe this isn't original research, yada yada. But you found something new. I mean, this is the important thing, right? I mean, we look at Windows, you know, all the time. We think we know everything, and you actually did find, legitimately, a new execution artifact that, as you said, if the attacker's advanced enough to get rid of all the rest of the stuff, you finally found another source that people could look at and find out maybe what else happened. So I think that's awesome.
Yeah, I agree with you.
So what's next for you, Oleg? What's the future hold for Oleg Skulkin?
If we are talking about some next research and next posts, yeah. As we are all still working remotely, at least here in Moscow, many companies still working remotely, and we are having much more incident response recently.
Yes, same here.
And so I Googled a bit, and I think I'm planning to write a series of articles on artifacts for different remote access tools like AnyDesk, TeamViewer, etc. For example, I did some research on AnyDesk. I tried to Google, maybe somebody already did, and somebody already find something about artifacts that AnyDesk live on hard disk, but I haven't found anything, so I think it's going to be the next post.
Nice.
Research is ready, but I just need to put it into an article or into a blog post. And I think next Sunday Funday.
That's right. let's see. If somebody wanted to reach out to you, they wanted to have you do an incident response job for them, or if they want to talk to you about your research, is your Twitter the best way to get a hold of you?
Yeah, sure.
Yep. And so that's right below his name. You can see it right there, at Oleg Skulkin.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Oleg, thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So this is fun, right? Because I have emailed with Oleg over the years. I have, you know, treated with Oleg over the years. I've read his posts over the years. So it's great to finally have Oleg on the show, and everybody can actually, you know, put a human face to Oleg. And I think you know, a lot of you out there that are kind of doing stuff on a daily basis don't realize that people, you know, even if you only see 100, 500, or 1,000 views, maybe even 10 views, that's still 10 people that are interested in your work and 10 people who want to know more about you, who you are, and why you're doing it. Which leads us to our next guest, someone who you may not have seen before, because Brian is a, well, be frank, is a rock star in our group here at KPMG, but is probably not a household name yet. So, Brian.
Hey, Dave.
Let's talk about what... there you go, your video is back. Let's talk about Office 365 breaches and what you've been seeing.
Thanks. So what I'd like to talk about today was actually hot off the press whenever we originally planned to do something like this in person in early March. But mm-hmm. And because of circumstances, things got delayed. And, you know, we're here now and it's still good info that people may have missed. So what I wanted to talk about today was that not so long ago, there were rumors about a secret O365 log that could tell if an email was accessed or not.
Yep.
And I'm just going to leave that at that because that's a whole can of worms that you probably have three-parter forensic lunch on that. But there was an update released by Microsoft in late February that there is now a field that is logged called Mail Items Accessed, mm-hmm. which is intended to track an email if an email was accessed or not.
Yep.
So what I'd like to quickly cover today is a brief overview of the information released by Microsoft, some sandbox testing I did in our sandbox environment, and then walk through an example of the new log entry.
Yeah, that'd be great. Especially since, you know, for those of you who are currently working IR, you'll know that the Office 365 compromises have not gone away. In fact, we are seeing attacker activity increase all over the board. You know, luckily, our attackers can work from home as well. So, Brian, I think this is quite topical. Now, Brian, one thing I wanted to talk about, this one we talked about, is that it seemed like only E5 subscriptions were getting this by default.
That's correct. That's the catch.
So, if you pay up... you right. can get it back.
Yeah, so here's the Microsoft documentation for
let me switch over to your shared screen. Oh. 1 second. There we go.
Yeah, so here's the Microsoft documentation for mailbox auditing, and I'll throw this URL in the chat later. And so if we scroll down to the log types. Mm-hmm. So here we have mail items accessed. It says mail data is accessed by mail protocols and clients. This value is only available for E5 or E5 compliance add-on subscription users. For details, see this access to crucial events for investigators. So we'll jump to that next, but I'll just cover these three columns and what these check marks and asterisks mean. So the columns are admin, delegate, and owner. And before the check mark like that, it was only logged for admin. And so the update is now owner it's being logged for, which is huge because you don't want to have everyone in your environment to be an admin. It's only logged for them. And then the asterisk means that it's logged by default, but they have the little caveat here. It's only for E5s. And then so we'll jump into access to crucial events for investigation. So this covers a little bit more information around the difference between message bind, which is what this mail items access replaced. So again, it was only for audit admin. I have some notes on the differences of those that we'll go over. So you can poke around this site if you want to read more, but then this is also a good reference here. Use advanced audit to investigate compromised accounts. And that is definitely a use case for people nowadays. So this article walks through some of the considerations you should have whenever using mail items access for a mail compromise investigation. It talks about the difference between sync access and bind access, throttling of the logs, kind of like a quick thing, how to pull a few logs, and then filtering duplicate records, identifying the access contacts of different audit records. So this kind of walks through an example of an attacker using two different IP addresses in the same session. It's kind of showing you that they'll track over the same session ID, so you can tell that those were the emails accessed for that session, even if the other attributes change. And yeah, that's the bottom of that. So you guys can check that out if you want to learn more. But basically, the high level of this is, it's a little bit bigger. It's released in mid-February 2020. So if you're dealing with an incident before this, and we're about 60 days away from there, and the UAL is only 90 days, so you would only have logs going back that far. Is available to E5 tenants or with an E5 compliance add-on subscription. And that could be interesting if you have a few users that handle sensitive data and they do have a risk to, if they're compromised, that there is sensitive data, you want to know if it was accessed or not. If you could potentially just do an add-on subscription on a per-user basis for those, that's something to talk to Microsoft about. It's enabled by default if you're lucky enough to have those type of tenants, the license. Compared to the old operation, Message Bind, it's all users as well as admins. It's all mail protocols and all clients. And then the events are deduplicated. There is some duplication issues with Message Bind. So in my testing, I noticed that the bind access was whenever you have individual access, such as webmail, or like Outlook iOS app, basically anything that's like hitting through modern access, like a modern API, is going to log in bind, like the bind method. And it will log multiple items transferred to the device.
Interesting.
Over that bind access. And then there's a total items listed in the operation count field. So you can use that to assist in your investigation, to get a count of those numbers. You can also just individually count up the fields, but they end up for you there. Go ahead.
I don't know if you saw Pierre's message in the chat, but he says, the interesting part is that if your company is an E3 license for most employees, but a few E5 licenses, then it actually shows up for all users.
Interesting. I haven't tried it. I've only tried on an E5 tenant. There you go. Get one E5 user. Mm-hmm. And keep that between yourselves. On the hood, doesn't be like that. So thank you, Pierre. And then for sync access, this is the legacy protocols, like IMAP, POP3, things like that. And that's only going to list that a folder was synced. And so it would just list the folder, and you can just assume that all the mail items were accessed in that folder. Interestingly enough, in my testing, whenever I was using IMAP to pull down an account with only a few emails, 10, less, around those numbers, IMAP was actually logging in this bind form because it was just a few messages. Mm-hmm. There must be some threshold that triggers to really have a big sync occur. Mm-hmm. But either way, like it seems like Microsoft built this mail access gateway on the back end that whenever mail is being accessed, it's going through that, it's logging, it's putting it into these buckets and in these events. So I guess now we'll walk through an example of one of the events. So here you see the operation is mail items accessed. The record type is 50, and I put this comment in here. This is from the documentation that this is related to a mail items access, mailbox audit action. There's the success. This is the user ID in the test tenant. There's the IP address. Logon user. So here in the operation properties, we have mail access type bind is throttled false. So let me cover that. I didn't have it. Maybe throttling's back at the other page. Oh no, I want to find this because it's pretty important. Okay, throttling. So if there is more than 1,000 items accessed in less than 24 hours, it's going to stop generating audit records for mail items accessed.
That's unfortunate.
Yeah. So they claim that less than 1% of all mailboxes are throttled, that they don't typically see more than 1,000 mail items being accessed. And it's only for the mail items access being throttled, all the other activity is there. So if you do see this throttled, you can assume a lot more than 1,000 mail items were accessed, and pretty much that entire mailbox, that entire folder. So something to consider in your investigation. So in this case, the is throttled is false. So if you're looking at this activity, you're definitely going to want to search for is throttled true, because that will have those implications. As I said, the mail access type was message bind. Oh, sorry, I skipped over here. The client info string is Outlook iOS. So that's why it's bind. I'm using a modern application to access this. And then here are the folder items that were accessed.
Now, before you go any farther there, Pierre says, given an internet message ID, have you found a way to extract that specific message? The get message commandlet doesn't seem to have an option to search based on message ID.
Done a couple different techniques for this. You can definitely download the entire PST and then ingest that and filter on internet message ID. I swear in the Graph API, I was able to filter by internet message ID. Not 100% positive, but I think I was able to.
Okay. Anatoly says, is there any way to reveal the mailbox from the audit log? Anatoly, the answer is yes, and specifically that's what we're showing here. This is after an authentication has occurred, and this is the attacker who's accessing either individual messages, syncing the whole mailbox itself, or they're using IMAP to sync certain folders. Now, what I found, Brian, is that ID right there, the folder ID at least, you can translate to an EWS ID, and you can use that via OWA to retrieve things. But by internet message ID, that I have not found.
Okay.
Spencer says, yes, you can use the Graph API.
Okay, yeah. So check out the Graph API, and if you're going to play around with the Graph API, I really recommend you go to the Graph Explorer. Just type in the Google, like, O365 Graph Explorer. Start playing around with that. And on the subject of exfil, I also did some experimentation accessing attachments, and there's no distinction, there's no mention of attachments separate from this. So if the mail item is accessed, you should consider that a whole document of everything, even the attachments.
And for those wondering why that would be true, it's because the attachment is embedded in the email.
Yeah.
All right. This is cool, right?
And then, yeah, at the end, there's operation count of 6. I think these are a max of 10 in size. And then if there was 26 access, you would see 10, 10, then 6.
And so to be clear for those who are watching this, that means that these 6 different message IDs were accessed from this one audit event.
Yes. During this session, sorry, that was the other important thing to cover, that they're saying you could come from multiple IP addresses and other attributes, but then the session ID will remain the same.
Very cool. Yeah, I think this is helpful. So if you're out there doing Office 365 compromises, and you probably are, let's be honest, these are, unless you have MFA, this is probably something that's rampant out there across multiple tenants, multiple people, multiple clients. We're seeing it too. This is, if you're lucky enough to get it, the mailbox items accessed. Anything else you want to talk about, Brian?
No, that's it. Right. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's see. Pierre says, Anatoly, One thing, hold on, wait for the chat to come back. Here we go. One thing I would look for is the bad guy setting up forwarding S&T address on a mail. Yes, yes. This is something that we see all the time that Pierre's bringing up, which is that you can actually set up forwarding rules inside someone's mailbox. And if you're doing, I think I've heard it as man in the email. I've heard some other bad marketing terms around this. But basically, if they're intercepting emails in between, forwarding them off to misspelled domains so they can hijack conversations, you can actually see in the audit logs that these forwarding rules have been created. All right. So that leaves us to end the show with everyone's friend, Lee Whitfield. Hey, Lee.
Everyone but Matt's, apparently.
Lee, let's talk, because the time is running out, about the nominations for the Friends of Quarkcast Awards. Let's start with, how has the nominations been going? Have you been seeing more activity than usual?
It's probably on par with what I've seen. I think that, barring some miracle, we're probably at saturation levels now, with Cellbrite and Magnet and everyone else sending out fairly constant reminders to people. If anyone who hasn't heard of the Forecast Awards by now, I'd be quite surprised.
Well, maybe someone isn't one of their customers.
Maybe.
At least someone from Cellbrite will be there to get a trophy these days.
That's right. Yeah, now that have both Heather and Sarah.
True.
However, Lee, this year, no one will be physically present to retrieve the reward.
That will also be true, yes. I mean, we talked about this previously, I think, that that Sens has announced that they're going to move the DFIR summit this year from being in person to being a virtual only conference. Still the same dates and everything else, and the Forensic Forecast Awards will still definitely be a part of that conference.
Very cool. And you're going to be broadcasting the awards online.
Yes. It will still be part of the summit. Mm-hmm. I'll likely record it and then put it up on YouTube very quickly thereafter, just for those who can't actually physically watch it at that time.
Now, well, it's because before we've had it, if you didn't pay for a ticket to the summit, that you could still go to the awards. Is the award stream going to be public, or is it going to be to ticket holders only?
That I don't know yet.
Okay.
That's a Rob, Phil, and Heather question, because okay. I don't know.
Mark asks, is that a COVID-19 curtain behind you?
Yeah, I stitch it together out of masks, yes.
So, Lee, one of the reasons I wanted you to come on, obviously, to talk about it, but, you know, for those things that are not involving commercial products, those categories, I'm guessing that those might still be open to some nominations, maybe a turn in the tide. Let's talk about those categories. But first, hold on. Cyber Panther has a question. He says, I just started my DFIR journey a few weeks ago. I find myself all over the place, leveraging on your experiences. If you could do it all over again, where would you start your learning from? Lee, this is a great question.
It is. Sans is my answer. In fact, it's funny that you should mention this, because just last week I had the privilege of joining three very good forensic practitioners in a webcast that Sans did. I will endeavor to find the link to that and share it. It's going to be difficult if I talk and do that at the same time, though.
Come on.
But yeah, Sans webcast, the four of us held a panel about how we each got into the field, mm-hmm. Useful ways in which we have found to learn from, different areas where we've chosen to learn different things and how we've learned it, different resources and all that kinds of stuff. So it's well worth finding and checking that out.
What about you, Brian Marks? What would you recommend to someone who is just starting? Where should they go first?
Sans is a really good option. That's what really gave me a push early in my career, but not everyone has that option available to them, unfortunately. Yeah. I got a lot of value out of doing like capture the flag competitions, nights and weekends, studying and learning that stuff.
Absolutely. Matt?
Practical hands-on stuff.
What would you say, Matt?
My first, which in this case you've probably already done, is definitely just finding some good people to follow on Twitter and then find out, you know, kind of the DFIR people that are making a lot of impacts in the community. And then after that, yeah, absolutely doing things like Sunday fun days, getting your hands dirty, you know, building your own parsers for stuff, or absolutely finding some of the influencers in the community, and that gives you a good way to establish, you know, what's happening and kind of where you should be looking to get where you can find your research, where you can start fitting into the overall picture.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Oleg?
I think classics are great. Maybe it's a good place to start is Holland Curry's books.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Maybe File System Forensic Analysis. Maybe Instant Response and Computer Forensics, mm-hmm. third edition. I think it's still quite okay to start from those books.
Yeah. Yeah, I would agree with all that. And CyberPanther, I think it really depends on which aspect of DFIR you want to start in. Because I think all of us started probably long ago enough where DFIR was about Windows endpoint analysis. And now it's grown into so much more. Mobile forensics is its own field. Windows and Mac forensics and Linux forensics are a thing. Endpoint for Deadbox versus malware. Malware versus engineering is its own thing. So I think the first question you should ask yourself is kind of these areas, what interests you? And then I would agree with Brian Markson that CTFs, I think, are great because people have written these detailed walkthroughs of how to solve the CTF, so it kind of actually exposes you to a lot of the concepts that you may not have seen before and artifacts, and you can play and learn from them. So that's where I would start, and it's free. Meteor Kicks is which books? I would definitely say Harlan's books are great if you need a reference on the Windows Registry. He also has some. He goes through different CTF images. And then in addition to that, someone is typing very loudly. The incident response book that was recommended by Oleg. I think that was originally Kevin Mendio's book, I think. That's a great one. The File System Forensics book is an excellent reference book, but I think if you don't already have an academic background in computer science and you're comfortable kind of being in Hex, I wouldn't start there personally. I'm going to be completely honest. I think a lot of people get lost there, and it becomes kind of like applied cryptography. It's a book that you have on your shelf, and you look at it occasionally, but you never read it. And that's because the only reason you're reading that book cover to cover, in my opinion, it would be if you're actually writing a file system parser. So there you go. Any good recommendations for CTFs? There's a lot. CyberPanther, I'd recommend just going to my blog and clicking on a CTF. There should be 4 or 5 out there that you can go see, and then there's multiple others that have been posted by Sans and other people.
Doesn't About DFIR have a page just for CTFs too? So aboutdfir.com.
There you go. All right, so lead back to the topic in question. Let's go through these categories for nominations, because I think there has been some confusion in some people and what they've been nominating. So I think commercial tool of the year is pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Non-commercial tool of the year.
Yep.
Now, this is software, right? Not a person.
Definitely software, yes. And it can be any kind of free or open source software.
Yep. Oh, and Brian just posted out, and this is, I forgot about this, that Basis is currently offering their autopsy training for free until May 15th. So that is a great idea for someone who does not have a large budget. So DFIR Show of the Year. Now, this was funny because I saw that Heather Mihalik actually suggested a trade show rather than a podcast, a webcast, or a YouTube show. She said techno security.
Interesting. That was not the intent of that particular category. and if I even did a video about this a couple of months ago while I was bored in my hotel in Arizona. So, yeah, I mean, technically that's going to be podcast, webcast, YouTube show, anything of that particular nature. Like, so Forensic Lunch would be part of that, 13 cubed, you know, the single
episode.
Yep, this month in forensics, the single episode of Forensic Forecast we've had in the last 3 years. things of that nature.
But one thing you should know, Tio, is this is for 2019.
Yes.
And not 2020.
Yes.
Yes, that's Lee's always been strict with this.
Yep, all of the nominations and votes will be for work that was performed in 2019.
Yep. Let's see. Kev says, is there a book with newer file systems? No. No, Kev, there's not. but there are lots of blog posts and research papers out there with newer file systems. Sorry, Kev. We've all actually bothered Brian about this, and he said that that's the great thing about writing a file system forensics book is you don't have to update it. Shrek the Ogre says, are chats messages with URLs from non-moderators blocked? Yes, they are. That's a YouTube thing, not something I can fix. I'm sorry. Let's see. Blog of the Year, Lee.
That should be pretty self-explanatory, but we'll go through that. Right? That's not just a single blog post. Okay, that would come under a different category further on. But Blog of the Year would be someone who consistently writes good blog posts. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much it.
All right, let's see. Book of the Year. Now, this seems like it's becoming a harder thing because it feels like less books being written per year.
Yeah, and I've toyed with the idea of this being one of those categories that kind of disappears into the distance at some point. But there's still people posting nominations for several different books, and so I don't know. It's a difficult one because I know some people who have written books in the past, like you, and then people who would like to write books, people who are currently writing books. I know it's no small effort to do so, and so I don't want to just exclude it just for the sake of the fact that it doesn't get very many nominations. But
yeah, I agree with that. So Matt, one thing we haven't done is talk about who we would nominate. So Matt, who is your commercial tool of the year? Matt's on mute.
I am on mute, but not anymore. I think I'm just going to go with Axiom again. It's probably the commercial tool I use the most. I don't get in a whole lot of commercial tool use.
So I'm going to bring in someone who is not a newcomer, but someone who I've been using a lot more and been pushing a lot of updates. Forensic Email Collector. Forensic Email Collector would definitely be my nomination for the year. I don't know if they're going to, you know, be able to compete with the big people to actually get a vote for the official voting, but I think it's been a great tool. What about non-commercial tool of the year, Matt?
You know, I think I'm probably going to go with the Rust Event Parser. Because Ben Amran did an amazing job with that. I doubt it's going to get any traction. Maybe not even a whole lot of people know about it, but I've never been able to parse more event logs faster with as much precision as that tool.
Nice. I'd go with Apollo. I think what Sarah's been doing around the iOS and Mac OS, basically data aggregation around all of the database sources has been amazing. Matt, DFR Show of the Year, that's not us.
Oh, that's not us? Are we not allowed to vote for ourselves?
It's bad when you do.
Well, you can nominate yourselves, you just cannot vote for yourselves.
Ah, I should learn the rules.
If only they were written down somewhere.
I guess that's why everything else was nominated Clippy. I don't know.
Uh,
Show of the year, yep. And this is for 2019.
Correct.
So that rules out Alt-Control-Delete.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I'm going to have to think about show of the year.
I'm going to say 13 cubed. I think Richard's really been putting a lot of work and quality into what he's been doing. So let's see. Sarah is trying to nominate herself in the chat. Well done, Sarah. Self-promote. If you can't self-promote, no one will promote you.
You don't have Brian anymore to self-promote.
Oh, no. No, she has to be nominated first. Let's see. Blog of the year. Ooh, this is a tough one.
So this one, I am absolutely sure on what I'm going with. Ooh. And that is, I'm going with Maxim's blog, dfir.ru.
Yes.
This guy blows my mind every single time he does something. I wish the BAM stuff could have been done last year because that was cool. But the fact that this guy can just like whip out IDA and start debugging the Windows kernel and is like, oh, I know exactly what triggers this mechanism. It's just mind-blowing.
I would agree. I mean, when it comes to deep technical content on a regular basis of someone who pulls things out that I don't see from anybody else, I'd have to agree with Maxim.
Just going into the Linux kernel and being like, this is why software Linux kernel isn't blocking the journal from being written. Like, just wow.
Yeah, I agree. All right, Matt, are you aware of any book that was published in 2019 for DFIR?
I'm not.
Man, I don't know either. See, this is the one that's stumping me. I'm going to have to actually go to Amazon and see. I've just been reading blog posts.
So, I mean, one book that came out last year.
Hang on. Don't just fill stuff out. Like, just don't go on Amazon and be like, oh, look, there's an interesting book.
Too late. That's not a rule.
If you haven't read the book... Then let's not post the nomination. Oh, no. This is exactly how Catch is going to win all those Academy Awards.
All right.
And now that you have David Cowan doing it, everyone's going to do it.
That's not true.
I saw in the... in the open source Slack channel the other day, someone was like, oh, David Cowan said this was okay.
That is a different thing. That's someone who is specifically looking for people's opinions on whether or not it's okay to release Windows images and whether or not it's a violation of copyright.
But, just saying.
All right, DFIR article of the year. Ooh, for 2019. Matt?
You know, I got to go back, and I can't remember. All the time just kind of blends together, and I'm having trouble thinking of stuff done last year, but there's all sorts of stuff that I love that's been done this year, so I just kind of need to go back through. And
yeah, this is probably going to be the hardest one for me, because there was so much good stuff, like detailed analysis that was posted last year. I'm probably going to put several submissions for this. You know, you got... what Sarah did, what Alexis did, you have what Maxim has been doing, you have, I mean, there's been a bunch. I mean, even Nicole's, you know, Dia Store parsing stuff that she put out last year, there's been so much.
So I wanted to go with some of the Linux write blocker stuff. Or write blocker, some of Maxim's write blocker stuff, but either, I couldn't find anything that was last year. And I thought some of it was last year, but his like his Linux kernel one was 2017.
So Lee, is there any kind of restrictions we should think about when it comes to article of the year?
Not really. I mean, it doesn't have to just, it can be blog, it can be journal, you know, forensics magazine, anything like that. I think that one of the primary reasons for this is that sometimes, like if you have like the Sans blog, for example, that it's not all the same authors over and over again. And so someone might just post one thing one time and that would be commendable enough for them to get the award.
Nice. All right. Social media contributor of the year. Now, Lee, I like how MySpace is included in this category, number one. But number two, what is, if you were to gather your ability to influence people's opinions on what they should nominate here, what in your mind makes a great social media contributor?
Someone that interacts with people that follow them, who shares good articles or generates good conversation about certain topics and, you know, things like that. Not someone who, like me, appears on Twitter like once every 2 months and then disappears again.
All right. Matt, who is your social media contributor of the year?
You know, I'm trying to figure out who I'm going to go with in the end, but it could be between Hacking Exposed Computer Forensics Blog or Lit Muse. I don't know.
I always go for Brian Moran. Brian Moran is always my social media contributor of the year. It's always quality.
If Brian Moran is yours, then I'm definitely going with Lit Muse.
There you go. Let's see. DFR degree program or training class of the year. Now, Lee, this says formal education program.
Yes.
What do you mean by that? Suits and ties? Tuxedos?
No, not quite that formal. This isn't going to be like some internal training that you take with whenever you join someone as an employee or something like that. This is going to be where you've gone to learn from the people in the know about whatever it is that you're trying to learn about. So, you know, it could be the university that you go to has a great degree program on digital forensics. It could be a specific class which SANS or their what's the word I'm looking for? It's not opposition, but I'll go with it. SANS or the people in that same area offer, you know, things like that. It could be a training class offered by someone who writes the tools. So it could be like Cellbright have their own training, as does Axiom, Magnet, and even Encase training, stuff like that. Any of them are basically up for grabs.
Hmm. All right. Next is... Oh, wait, we haven't said anything. Matt, what is your DFI degree program or training class of the year?
I'm going to go with Champlain. I love what their students do, so it's hard. Otherwise, I guess it would be between Champlain and I took SANS 508 this year.
Yeah,
that was cool. But
I think the contract I signed says that I have to say SANS, so I'm going to say SANS.
Well, I mean, I'm kind of wondering about the bias at play here between you and Lee. So
there's bias.
And I think that next year, you'll be a shoo-in for this, won't you, Dave?
For newcomer of the year?
No, for training class of the year.
Oh, yeah, I hope so. I hope I'm done by then. So the joke that Lee's making, by the way, is the SANS 4509, the Cloud IR, Enterprise Cloud IR class that we're desperately trying to get done. All right. Most valuable threat intel contribution. Now, Lee, this has to be heavily, heavily pushed by vendors trying to win this, right?
You know, you would think so, but I haven't necessarily seen anything like that. I don't know if that's just an area which I don't have a lot of traction or whatever. I actually put this in as a recommendation from someone else.
Yeah.
It was a couple of different people, really. And I thought, well, yeah, we have all those reports coming out each year that show, you know, all the different trends and everything else. On top of that, we also have individual papers that are released saying, hey, you know, take a look at this. This is interesting. Various different websites. I mean, it's pretty much anything that involves with threat intel on some level. But which one has been perhaps the most influential in your own particular job?
Interesting. Matt, do you read anything?
As far as like I don't know, I'd say Firehole. There's nothing new about it, but I've been using it a little bit more lately. Hmm. And for me, it's just a cool kind of threat aggregation of like IP addresses.
For me, it's ThreatBot. It'll always be ThreatBot, no matter what. The answer will be ThreatBot. groundbreaking research of the year. Ooh, man. This is tough. Matt?
Yeah, I don't know yet.
Yeah, this is going to be a tough one. There's been a lot of research last year that got put out that was really helpful. And this is separate from article, right? So, in theory, you could have one person nominated for both.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Now, Sarah did not say that she should be nominated for this category in her chat message. Alexa says, checkmate. That would be interesting if those people were willing to give their address to Lee to ship him something. But I would agree with you, checkmate was an amazing bit of groundbreaking research in mobile forensics last year. All right, newcomer of the year. Now, that means, Lee, that this person had to have started doing DFIR last year, or they had to be kind of become public in the last year. What's your boundary condition?
I will accept either of those as perfectly adequate.
Matt, who's your newcomer of the year?
Thinking Farley.
Oh, Jack Farley. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I'd go Jack Farley.
You know what? I'm down with that. Yeah, he helped us out with pulling out that CTF for DEF CON when we were completely unprepared.
Oh.
So I agree. That deserves a nomination. Jack Farley for newcomer of the year. all right, here we go. Mentor of the year. Now, Lee, what would you say is the ideal mentor kind of behavior that you would hope to have represented here?
Well, that's a good question. If I ever find out, I'll let you know. I mean, it's someone who is who you're going to look up to, who's going to bring you in to an organization or into a field and show you the ropes. Help you with learning and guidance and whatever else. Now, this doesn't necessarily have to be someone who you work with or have worked with. This can be, oh, well, I've engaged this person on Twitter and asked them a bunch of questions, and they took valuable time out of their life to correspond with me and help me out, and put in a huge amount of time to do this. It could be a formal educator. I don't, you know, that's fine. It could be, you know, even on like Reddit or whatever else, someone who offers a lot of assistance in like the computer forensics subreddit over there too. Mm-hmm. So anything of those kinds of categories would work for this.
This is a tough one, Matt. There's a lot of people out there that go out of their way to help. Where would you go?
For me, again, it's going to be the little person route, but I'm going to vote with my heart.
Yep.
I'm going to go with Ben Amran. Over the summer, that dude helped me out a lot and kind of helped me help further me technically. So that's where I'm going to go.
I'm going to go with the person I've seen who is probably the most passionate about this and will go out of her way to help anyone she can possibly even hear talking, and that would be Jessica Hyde. So
that is a solid one.
That's my mentor of the year. Resource of the year. So, Lee, this is not typically a blog. I like how you put that. So Phil's back in for this week of forensics.
Yes. So these are going to be things that are going to be think DFIR, about okay. DFIR, forensic focus, mm-hmm. And then also this week in forensics. So things of that type of nature, things which don't easily fall under the category of blog, but help people to, or DFIR training was another one I didn't mention. All of these are interesting things which I think more than deserving of some kind of nomination.
So I would nominate two here for the year. So of course I would nominate Phil, because I would say out of any resource that I read on a weekly basis that kind of helps me see what I'm missing, it's This Week in Forensics. No question. But I would say the other one that I'm really starting to, I'm probably lurking more than I'm talking. There's probably two, and that would be the open source Slack. If you would count that as a resource, or I don't know if that's a team. And then the DFIR Discord. I think both of those for me have become valuable sites to kind of be able to collaborate and see what people are doing, even if all I do is lurk there and kind of see what people are talking about.
I was going to say, I didn't even know you were in the Discord. I thought I would have seen you by now.
I've known that. Most times I'm just watching. I'm always afraid that if I start saying too much, I'll take over a conversation. Matt, what about you? Resource of the year.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Phil on this one. Mm-hmm. I think it's probably the one I use the most. I absolutely love the open source Slack channel, and I've used it quite a bit, but I think I use this week in forensics more.
Yeah, I'd agree. Oh, here we go. Team of the year. Now, I think Matt and I, again, will have a different opinion than Lee because of our contractual obligations. But Lee, when you said team of the year, where are the boundaries here?
There's not really any boundaries. I mean, this could be an organization. It could be a specific team inside an organization. It could even be just a group of people that work together in some kind of context, not even working for the same employer. Just someone who, or a group of people who have shown something exceptional over the last year, whether it's helping their clients, helping other people in the field, or whatever else, just any of those would work.
So Matt, you know who you have to say, right?
You know, it's a hard one, but I'm going to have to go with the KPMG Cyber Response.
That is the correct answer, Matt. KPMG Cyber Response is who we are obligated to say.
Shortly underneath that, I might go with the DFIR Dinosaur Team.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, DFIR Dinosaurs. Lee, thank you for the opportunity for us to suggest our employer.
What is DFIR Dinosaur Team?
Oh, that's Brian Moran's fitness group.
It's the team of dinosaurs that show up to the fitness groups for the DFIR fit.
I mean, the zebras are also pretty great.
I'll say this. I'd have that as opposed to Clippy, so that's fine.
Ooh, I like Kevin's description better. DFIR Dino Squad.
All right, and now the number one thing that everyone wants to win every year. The biggest bragging rights category there is, Digital Forensics Investigator of the Year, a field so dominated by Eric Zimmerman that he has a crack team of law enforcement agents at all time willing to vote for him. So, Matt, first, Lee, are you putting any restrictions? Because you talked in the past about maybe retiring some people or something like that, or is Zimmerman still fully eligible for nomination?
You should do a Hall of Fame after
he's
after
talked about
three
it. He's
Hall
talked
of
about
Fame.
It.
We are doing a Hall of Fame this year. All right. So was it three different awards that Eric walked away with last year?
Yeah, he tied me up.
Yep. Let's revisit that remark. Interesting.
Eric and I may compare things.
Is that why you're tied up?
Yep.
Let's not go there. Okay. All right. So, I'm not going to outright say this, but I suspect that Eric will at least get one award this year based on a specific tool that he released last year.
I believe that.
So if people would like to vote for Eric for writing said tool, then please do so. But I would ask that you put it into the appropriate category and leave this one maybe for someone else to win this year.
Matt, who would you say is your digital forensic investigator of the year?
You know, I think based off of some of my previous nominations, it's pretty explanatory. I'm going to go with Maxim.
I'm also going to go for Maxim. And while, you know, Eric and I are good buddies, and I would happily nominate Eric Indie of the Week, I do feel like Maxim's extreme knowledge is something that should be recognized. So, all right. Oh, and Brian Marks is Alejandro. Yes. And Alejandro Perez, of course.
I nominate him for every category. Even like Software of the Year. Just him.
Brian, you're one of those people who just wants to let the world burn.
Sorry, Lee.
Sarah says, Alexis Brigoni. I agree. Alexis is also another great nomination. He's been putting out a ton of stuff. Again, this is one of those things, right, where, like, sometimes feelings get hurt when Matt and I will throw out a name. And it's not that we are not appreciating everybody else's work when we don't say your name. We're thinking about them. We talk about you guys all the time. It's just that if we have to pick one person that we would nominate, you know, that's who resonates with us the most, not that the other ones don't. And I think that's hard.
I want Maxim to be recognized. Like, I feel like, and I mean this in the best way, but, like, I feel like Sarah and, you know, everyone else, they get a lot of recognition. I don't feel like Maxim gets that much recognition, but his stuff is mind-blowing.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. Lee, anything else you want to say? When is the nominations over?
Nominations actually close in 2 weeks.
There you go.
May 15th, they'll close, and then in the next couple of days after that, the voting will open. And then voting, actually this year, because I don't have to be in a rush to get all of the awards carved in time for the summit, I'm probably going to let the voting run up until the day of the awards.
Ooh. All right. So everybody who thinks you're going to get nominated, you might want to reach out to Brian Moran now to get your campaign manager reserved.
And make sure that he's representing someone else.
Lee, anything else you want to talk about before we close things out?
If you nominate Clippy in any way, shape, or form, you receive a lifetime ban from being nominated or posting anything.
Thanks, Lee. Well, we went way over time today, but that's okay because we had the time to do it, and we really appreciate you know all of you guys sticking around with us for so long. It's almost 30 minutes past the hour, and you still have a healthy crew of people still in the chat having a good time. So let me take advantage of these next 5 minutes before my next conference call to tell you two things. Number one, next week on the show, we're going to have Jack Farley. We're going to have. And if you don't know, Jack Farley, who we're talking about from Champlain, the DFA, who did the CTF, he's come up with a tool called Meet. We're going to have him come on and talk about. We're going to have Josh Brunty come on from Marshall. We've had a lot of different academic programs come on, and I thought it would be good to make sure that more were represented, talking about what they have for their students and what they can do to help you in your career. We're talking about bringing on Jim Arnold from our group and Silence, talk about some of the trends they're seeing within the attack space right now. And again, we're going to try this again. We're trying to bring on whoever happens to win this week's Sunday Funday, kind of bring them on to the broadcast as well. So other than that, the other thing to know, and Lee says, Eric, Kine, Dave up, have nightmarish weeks. Lee, you need to get your mind out of the gutter. That's terrible. Is that coming up on May the 12th, I believe. Brian, is it May the 12th? Let me double check my calendar. May the 12th, I believe, is the Magnet CTF. And the Magnet CTF is on the 12th? Yes. So at 4:30 Central on May the 12th is the Magnet CTF. And if you have not signed up for the Magnet Virtual Conference, which is absolutely free and runs through the entire month of May, you absolutely should. There's no reason not to. It's a free virtual conference of all the speakers you would have paid for. But there is a CTF that's going to run as well. has to be put on by Jack and the rest of the DFA and Jessica, who collaborated together to make it. But Matthew, Brian Moran, and I will be doing colorful commentary during the event, and we will be covering and talking about who's winning and talking trash. So make sure to tune in for that, and I hope you guys all play and have a lot of fun. So that's what we have for you this week. Thank you very much for tuning in. Tell your friends that the Forensic Lunch is now every Friday. Let's see if we can get my channel finally under partner status, so that way maybe I can get some more stuff out of YouTube. So that's it. See you next week. Thanks for watching.